Nags Head Board of Commissioners, mid-month meeting, please come to order. Do we have a motion for adoption of the agenda?
So moved.
Second.
Moved and seconded. Any discussion? Not all in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed, like sign, and there being none, it's ordered. This time we'll have our public comment section. If you have a matter to bring before the board that's not later on the agenda, please do so at this time. We would ask that you would hold your comments to no more than 5 minutes, please, and we'll ask Mr. Light if he would be our timekeeper.
Yes, sir.
Does anyone like to come before the board at this time? Yes.
Mr. Mayor and Commissioners, good evening. Thank you for this opportunity for public comment. My name is Stuart Pack. I'm a resident of Nags Head, and I currently serve as the CEO of Resort Realty. I just wanted to come tonight and share a couple ideas. I know that under the new business, you're discussing the solid waste management. I know there has been discussions. I have looked at the agenda. I've looked at the proposed letter as I understand it. I would just like to share with you, as a resident and as a member of the vacation rental management company, I clearly understand the concerns. I will share with you that anytime that I visit a house during the week or on a Saturday for inspections, either the first or last thing that I do is I will pull trash cans back. So it is an eyesore. I understand the concern. Whether I am in work clothes or whether I am in a company shirt, or whether I even have a necktie, I've been seen pulling in cans with a necktie on because I do believe in it. I do understand there's major concerns, different discussions here as far as the obligation. Also know that I believe there's some discussion on the actual days of trash pickup. From my perspective and from many of the vacation rental management companies, Monday, Friday is much better for the days of trash pickup. Resort Realty manages approximately 210 homes in Nags Head. So I'm looking at the cost, the obligation, if we are required to pull the cans back and forth. I believe there was some discussion as far as a penalty or a fine to the homeowners. I'm sure that's still under discussion. And again, I would ask for your ongoing consideration. I understand that it's a nuisance. I understand it's a burden to the town. Likewise, I would like to share that it's a burden to the vacation rental management companies. We certainly would ask our guests, and we put signage in the house, please bring the cans in or out. They do it or they don't. When the trash is overflowing on during the week or on a turn day, Saturday or Sunday, if we get the phone call, all the vacation rental management companies are going to respond. I mean, we don't have a trash truck, but we will go pick up trash. I know that the year is already in place. I know that all the vacation rental management companies are securing reservations, and we're doing well, so we're thankful for that. The leases, the fees, everything has gone out. As far as changing a fee structure or finding a way to pay for this, that's not an option in the current year. I certainly know, serving on the tourism board with Susie, I know that the town of Nags Head enjoys a great percentage of the tourist or the occupancy tax revenue. So again, I'm just asking for your ongoing consideration, as I do not see that there's an immediate solution to the current issue. Thank you for your consideration.
Thank you very much, Mr. Pack. Are there others who'd like to come before the board at this time?
Good evening. I'm Dan Hardy, and I'm the president at Joe Lamb Jr. and Associates in Kitty Hawk. Our company currently manages about 250 homes in Nags Head. I do applaud the town for trying to make the appearance better, because the trash cans are a problem. They always have been. Even going back to the days of the trash cans and the racks, I mean, it actually seemed to work better then as far as the appearance, because they're all in one place. But we knew that couldn't continue. The timing of this, if it falls upon us as a management company to do it, I honestly don't know how we're going to do it. management agreements are in place and have been since July of last year, and not a word in those management agreements about pulling trash cans back. If we've got to make provisions for them, we need to have that in our agreement with our homeowners so that it's well understood in advance that, you know, this is going to be happening, and not trying to chase them down and argue with them over the cost of pulling a trash can back. So perhaps education to the tenant, signage on the individual properties, a uniform response to this from all management companies might be a better way to go here. Every guest that checks into one of our homes gets an individual letter, and it's specific only to that property, and it tells them the garbage pickup days for that house, not for a house in Corolla or Kitty Hawk. It's about the house they're in Nags Head. We tell them when we check in, we go over those rules and we ask them to abide, but they just don't. I'm not sure what's going on. I mean, we all have to live with the tourists here, and we all know it's difficult. So I think education, and at least if we're going to do something, that we at least wait until we can get our hands around it and come up with a solid plan to make this thing work for everyone. I know the town does receive a lot of occupancy tax. Those occupancy taxes were specific for garbage and refuse pickup, so I know you get a lot of money for that. We just don't have it in our agreement now to cover the cost of doing this. But I do applaud you for you know, looking at a way to make it better, because I agree it's something that does need to be addressed, and perhaps we could work together to come up with some solutions that work for everyone instead of just going ahead and changing the ordinance now without any advance notice. And I noticed that your letter to the homeowners said nothing about fining them if they don't comply. And I'm going to ask, what are you going to do about the homeowners that don't rent their cottages? The homeowners that come down here on the weekend and leave their trash out when they leave on Sunday, and it's not picked up until Tuesday, and the can's going to sit there all week. They don't have anyone to work for them. Finally, I think the day of pickup is a real issue. During the past season, we were constantly sending our maintenance guys out to take trash out of trash cans because the tenant, they were full, and they had to sit there until Tuesday. And the tenants are complaining. So that's not good for my management company, and I don't think it's good for the town as a whole. So again, I appreciate the time, and be glad to help in any way we can.
Thank you, Dan.
Yes.
Good evening. I'm Kara Beatty. I'm a rental manager at Village Realty and have been since 2007. I'm also representing Bob Oaks, who was unable to be here tonight due to a prior obligation. As Mr. Pack and Mr. Hardy have already expressed, several of the larger management companies have spoken, and the overall consensus is the concern about what the town is adopting in terms of the owner responsibility for the rollback. The concern is these are out-of-town homeowners, and fine or no, they may just simply choose not to do it. It then does become the responsibility of the management company. We are all equally invested in making sure this remains an attractive community, one that guests want to return to year after year. I was lucky enough to be on the trash committee, so some of you are familiar with my sentiments and those of Bob Oaks. But we would like to request changing the rollback on the beach road, or the pickup day back to the beach road, to Monday as it was in the past. I realize there are a lot of valid concerns as to why that was changed, but it seems that this problem has been always present yet compounded by the change in days. It is correct that we can educate the guest as much as possible. We can let them know about the pickup day. The fact is, they often miss it. And with Saturday being the overall large departure day, Saturday to Tuesday is just too much time. And with the winds on the Outer Banks the way they are, it often just blows around. And it is the problem of the management companies. So I appreciate you hearing us. Thank you for allowing us to speak. And we just hope that you would consider that request. Thank you.
Thank you. Are there others would like to come?
Good evening, Mr. Mayor, members of the Board of Commissioners. Thanks for giving me a few minutes to speak tonight. My name is Meade Gwen. I am the president of the Village of Nags Head Property Owner Association. And I, too, have been very fortunate to be a member of the Trash Committee, and we've had several meetings on this. And I thought that the last meeting that we had, where we had all of property managers there and people that had an interest in this issue were all there. And I thought we really came to a really good decision about kind of phasing this in and doing it step by step. I was under the impression that although a fine would be imposed on the owners for not complying, that this was going to be deferred and give this whole process a chance to build over the next couple of years. So I think that that's pretty fair. I went back and took a look at the budget at the Village of Nags Head. We in the village, recognizing this problem, contracted with a private vendor through our management company for a rollback service. And because I think that a lot of the properties are being rented, their cleaning service was rolling out the cans, but many times those cans would be out there for days until they were being picked up, and then it would be up to our contracted person to roll all the cans back. They weren't just rolling them back for only the rental units, but they were being rolled back also for second homes and for homes that have full-time residents. So it was for everybody within the village. I went and took a look at what we were paying for this roll back service to the houses. We're paying about $30,000 a year for this service. And primarily, who is it for? The people that have second homes here that are not here, no garbage is being created, cans are not going out, and therefore there's no problem with cans coming back. For people like myself who live here full time, we take them out and we bring them back pretty much the day before and the day that they're picked up, we roll them back. So that's not a problem. But effectively what's happening is everyone in the village is paying for a service to benefit the rental units only. So my point is that I think that the committee has made great recommendations to the town to address this problem, and I would very much like to see the town proceed with the recommendations that were made at the last meeting that we had. Thank you very much.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. Are there others who'd like to speak to the board at this time? If not, I'll declare our public comment section closed. At this time, Annette Ratzenberger, we have a presentation from the League of Women Voters.
Good evening. My name is Annette Ratzenberger, and I'm representing the Dare County League of Women Voters tonight. I'm here to present to you the board, the 2017 Citizens Guide. With complimentary copies of the guide have been published by the League since 1988. They are distributed annually to government and business offices throughout the community. We would like to acknowledge the county commission, municipalities, local businesses that contributed generously toward our publication expenses and acknowledge the support of the many employees who provided updated information. They're our unsung heroes, if you would. Our guide is published under the auspices of the State League of Women Voters Citizen Education Foundation. The guide provides names, addresses, phone numbers, and email addresses for national, state, county, and municipality officials. Additionally, the guide has information on governmentally funded recreation areas and services. 6,800 copies of this guide are being distributed by league members from Duck to Hatteras Village, Roanoke Island, and mainland Dare County. They are and will be available in libraries, post offices, the Baum and Fessenden centers, as well as town and county offices. The League of Women Voters is a nonpartisan political organization that encourages the informed and active participation of citizens in government. Publishing this guide is part of our continued commitment to provide pertinent information to our community's voters. Membership in the League of Women Voters is open to anyone of voting age, male or female. New members are always welcome, and thank you for your support, board, and I'm sure all of you will find the guide useful.
Annette, thank you so much, and thank the League of Women Voters for this great, great service that they provide. It's a very, very useful book. We use it all the time. Thank you.
Thank you, Annette.
You mind it, John?
You have an inside contact there?
Yeah. At least she handed it to you first.
Yeah.
To the right. This time we have Jenny Ash out of Bank Sporting Events with her annual report.
Good evening, Mayor and members of the board. Thanks so much for having us here as part of your agenda. Typically, we come and give you a little analysis of the previous years and our events. And typically, I'm here with Linda Wood, who has retired. She's packing up to go to Cuba for a trip. And I told her I'd tell everyone hello. She stepped out of her role that's been in place for years and years. And Patty McKenna, we're so glad to have at Outer Banks Sporting Events. And she is the interim membership director, so we're tag teaming at this time, and she'll start off about our look at 2016 and what's ahead. So thank you.
Okay, thank you.
Thank you for having us here. As you may know, Outer Banks Sporting Events has a multiple tiered mission. It's got four parts. We're putting on events to promote healthy living on the Outer Banks, provide resources for our two nonprofits that founded us, the Dare Education Foundation and the Outer Banks Relief Foundation. And all of this contributes to the economy on the Outer Banks. So we've got all those goals. In 2016, we had 8,185 registrants come to our events, and 13% we're local, so we feel like we are reaching out to keep our locals engaged in healthy activities. There's always room for growth, of course. And we've donated $85,000 this year to the two nonprofits and generated $8.5 million in in spending locally through our events. So if you want a little background on our demographics, we have it, 87% visitors. I think that's noteworthy. And 23% of those are first-time visitors to the Outer Banks. So we hope they're repeat visitors after that. As far as the healthy lifestyles, we have some partnerships locally with the school system, their GoFar program. Their students participate in our races at a reduced cost or no cost. The Outer Banks Hospital gets involved. Purchasing race registrations and having a training program for locals. And over the years, our events have generated $800,000 for the two charities. So a lot of good impact. And this past year, with each registrant, 3.6 guests came along, and that's actually up from last year when 2.8 guests came along. We get all this information from the registrations that the athletes fill out, and so when we do the math on all this, ends up generating $1.1 million spending on rental homes, $1 million of spending on the hotels, $6.4 million of spending on food, gas, and retail, $8.5 million spent locally by our event participants. It's good stuff. And I'm going to hand it over to Jenny so that I don't do all the talking to cover the economic impact in Nags Head.
Okay, thanks, Patty. This year we did take over Mike Kelly's running of the Leprechaun, so that's a new one too, and that's a little bit more of a local thing, but people are signing up from out of town, so we're excited about that. And then that is in Nags Head. So I was thinking as I was sitting there before I stood up, other than our triathlon in September, every one of our events either passes through or is in Nags Head. So you guys are sort of the stronghold on our support system a little bit. So hopefully in terms of where people stay and spend their money, it's right here too. So let's look at that. Okay, so this is sort of like narrowing in on Nags Head specific other than all of Dare County where Patty was speaking to. So of our participants in 2016, almost 1,700 stayed in Nags Head. And then, like she said, the guest amount was on average 3.6. So our visitors to Nags Head specific were 7,800, stayed right here. So that's reflective of, I think, all the action that's here in your portion of our courses and everything. So on all accommodations, and that's hotels and rental homes combined, $626,000 spent here. And then on just per diem, we averaged $75 per day for our athletes as well as the people they brought with them. And then the number of days they stay on average is 2.8. So looking at all that combined over the time that the races are here, all throughout 2016 is $2.3 million of impact here in your immediate area. So we appreciate the support and continued availability to have that going on. And again, the impact of all of Dare County, you know, with you and from Kitty Hawk to Manio is really where it all comes together. So as with any operation, and we've got a lot of moving parts, there's some challenges that we look ahead towards. We were down a little bit in our numbers overall. So when Patty mentioned that people brought a few more folks with them each time, or on average, that sort of helped equate a little bit. But there are a lot of races all over our region, anywhere from Raleigh to Richmond, and the running market, and even though we branch out with Storm the Beach and the triathlon and try to keep things fresh, moving, and different, there's a lot of competition out there, so that's always a challenge. And the way in which we stay fresh is always important. So we can see that the bottom line, our charities that receive our net proceeds are the ones that obviously feel the difference too. So we're always looking at ways to improve. So we're always up for suggestions, especially as our events come through your area. So that's something that we, yeah. Oh, I forgot. That's hard to read that one. Sounds good. So with any challenges, we hope to turn it into an opportunity instead of glooming it as a problem. So we're looking ahead and trying to keep things on the up and up, as always. We are launching a new volunteer appreciation program so we can keep our communities involved and engaged in our events. The priority to keep people coming back on the race course itself, to have fun encouraging locals come out and people be a part of the race even though they're not actually participating, makes our community look like we're welcoming folks and make it a great experience overall. We're finding that more of the runner feedback is saying that it's not so much as Boston qualifying time or beating their last time, but the experience, even in general running races and everything. So, you know, we have the Atlantic Ocean and a beautiful location, and we're trying to play off that, of course. So with improved accommodation packages, we're going to look at some partnerships we can beef up with the hotels and rental companies. So you guys over there might want to have coffee later. Yeah. And then again, the overall course experience for our athletes and you know, personal outreach that we can enhance how people find out about us and bringing them here for a multitude of reasons, our race and then what else we have to offer. And we always want to add and be dynamic in what we offer. So we're looking at another event possibly in the winter when there's less action overall already. So just in terms of what you guys can do to help, if you're wondering. We have a great partnership going, so I'm going to let Patty talk a little bit about what we're hoping to move forward by doing.
You might remember the Colors program. Every town along the course was, you know, given a color, and houses and businesses and all decorated in that color. The roads were painted in that color, and I guess with all our success, somehow that didn't get the attention it needed, so colors are back, and Nag's Head is purple. Have for you a little reminder of your color, and you can pass this on to someone at town government who might like to be the contact, and we'll deliver them a purple package when the marathon gets closer in November, and you know, and communications from the town out to your residents can remind them. We'll give you a stencil again to spray paint your road. We'll make it fun and not too much, not burdensome, but fun. And we always welcome volunteers. You can go to our website and find out about that. We are down one at-large board member, so anyone in the community who has a stake and loves our races, you know, give us a call. And thank you. We've had so much success over the years, and we couldn't do it without all of the towns along the course and all your staff. It would not happen without you. If you need to contact us. Well, our next race is March 11th. Come on out and run with the leprechauns, and thank you very much. Just leave
that. And as a final, we have a parting gift for you all. For some wall in this building, I think there's some I see when I come in over there, the smaller versions.
We can get a smaller version
if it jives with your decor already. That'd be fine. Just let me know. But we have a beautiful piece of artwork for the 2016. Each year we have a watercolor, and this one's called Victory at Sea, and a local artist, Red Dawn, painted this, and it's a good addition to your navy blue walls. We got the frame just right. But thank you again for your time and efforts and partnership always. Thank you.
Thank you for your report and for all that you do for Nag's Head and for the Outer Banks.
Thank you.
Great effort. Thank you so much.
Business, Dave Ryan, you want to come and talk about shoreline management?
Say no. Mayor, if I could, I know at the last meeting you had the presentation from Tim Conn, and he presented to you the project in terms of him trying to get direction from you going forward as to the scope of permitting, you know, how much fill is he needing to go after in the permitting process. And I think the board wanted to try and get consensus with all of you here that to give maybe Dave the marching orders that can go back to Tim Conner to make sure he's on the right track. Also, one thing that the staff is looking for direction from, and as far as the staff planning and the town planning and going forward with the next beach nourishment project, is beginning to put together maybe a series or at least a couple of public input meetings, public information meetings that staff could take and maybe schedule at the appropriate time in March, sooner than later, to go ahead and start introducing to the public the ideas that are centered and focused on the next beach nourishment project, the scope of the project, the limit of the project. But somehow we have to be able to formulate a cohesive statement as to how the FEMA project will integrate into our next project, which is going to be difficult to do because it's such a moving target. But I think we just need, it's time for us to take the message to the public. So that, number one, they know that they can express, you can feel good that they've gotten an idea of what they can expect, and also gives them an opportunity. Y'all have got some difficult decisions that you're going to have to make in the coming months, and I'm sure you all want to hear from them and get their feedback, so this would give an opportunity for them to maybe ask questions at that time, for us to recognize the things that we learned from the first project that we need to fix moving forward with the shifting sand that everyone on the oceanfront, most everyone on the oceanfront had to deal with, how we're going to address that, as well as anchoring the south end of the project that we know we need to adjust in the next project, that anchor. So I think really, David, if I've missed anything, please include it. But I think we just want to make sure we've got the consensus that he needs going forward to report to Tim, and also to get any feedback or ideas you may have on going ahead and presenting the public information meetings.
Yeah, there's a couple updates that I'd like to go ahead and give the board. The critical path for the 2018 is the permitting aspect of that. And there is an unknown at this point with the sand losses from Hurricane Matthew. So based upon the last meeting, we have consulted with Tim Khanna and Coastal Science and Engineering to have them initiate that process, contact the state folks, arrange a scoping meeting with them. And that is based upon the recommendation that was given by the Shoreline Management Committee, plus the losses from Hurricane Matthew, and then 15% on top of that. For the permitting side, we want to go ahead and make sure that we're fully covered for all scenarios. When it comes down to it, and what we actually put on the ground may be something less than that when all is said and done, but at least we'll be covered from the permitting side, so we won't have to file any permit amendments, and we'll be able to move forward at that time when we are prepared for that effort. The other wrinkle is the Hurricane Matthew losses. We have been working with FEMA since post-Matthew. We have met with them at least monthly and sometimes more frequently here as of recent to provide them the information that they need to move forward with that public assistance reimbursement request. We have provided them all the background information that they have asked for, as well as supplemental information. And it looks like right now that process is going to be prolonged. The initial indications were 3 to 4 months, but right now, based upon the current feedback that we've received, it looks like that's going to be carried out through the end of the year. So as far as the board and the decision-making process, when start and looking at the financing part for the 2018 project, we're not going to have answers back from FEMA by the end of this fiscal year. So that's one of the considerations. I think that we've discussed that with the board in looking at some draft financing for this next project, just to initiate that conversation and try to give the board some guidance as to what the probable cost will be for this next project.
Okay, so from us, the board action you need tonight is a relative scope of the project, and so you can go forward with the permitting process. Is that correct?
Yes, sir.
And I think we had talked about 2.3 million cubic yards for that preliminary scope.
Yes, sir.
Is that correct? We need to have board action to give you that number to go forward with to start the permitting process or keep the permitting process going.
I think if we saw, I don't know if it takes a motion or just five heads nodding with consensus.
We have five heads nodding for that.
Nice question.
Yes.
I thought I understood we're going to start this permitting process assuming that FEMA will be coming along behind us. So we're really talking about 2.3 plus 1.4.
Right.
Plus 15%, correct?
That's correct.
Okay, so we're looking at the long term, and FEMA can catch up behind us.
Right.
Okay, that's fine. I just wanted to clarify that. So 2.3 of ours plus FEMA.
1.4 plus
15%.
Are we in agreement with that? Yes.
Yes, I just have. I'm in agreement. I just have a question.
Yes.
What is the once we receive the permit? How long is the permit good for? 1 year, 2 years? How long is that?
I don't know exactly what the term of that permit is, but I can get that answer for you.
Okay.
The previous one was 5 years.
5 years, mm-hmm. Okay. Thank you.
I'm okay with that, Mayor. Mm-hmm. I'm okay with moving.
Okay, everybody moving forward at that.
Yep.
The other thing that we need to do tonight is set some tentative public information dates in March, early April. Is that the other thing that we need to do?
Yes, sir.
Do we need to do that, or can staff develop those dates as they move forward?
I think if that's the direction, that'd be great. Yes, ma'am.
And I'd like a chance. The Shoreline Committee should meet next week with this guidance here, plus the idea of the committee itself has talked about education and information, and they're kind of chomping at the bit to get into that. So I'd like to give them a shot, along with staff, of coming up with a program to recommend to y'all.
Okay, so we will count on staff coming back to us with some proposed dates and what our public information session should be. Is that correct?
Yes, sir. Hopefully at your March meeting, we can kind of unveil all that to you and go ahead and set the stage for these meetings. What the purpose would be.
Okay. Is there anything else we need to do on shoreline management tonight? Any other questions for Dave?
All right. I think that should cover it from my end.
Okay. Got what you need then?
Yep. Yes, sir.
Okay. Yes, sir. Thank you.
Next item on the agenda is a resolution to acceptance of the Seagull Drive easement. You have that?
At your last meeting, February 1st meeting, because the property owners of the five houses on Seagull that are affected by the road closure, they have recorded an easement. They have received the CAMA permit that allows them to place access to their properties just west of the right-of-way or just west of the stable vegetated line or static vegetation line. So all that's in the works. Public Works has been out there and has dealt with the water meters and making sure they've all been relocated as they need to be. So all that's in motion. The attorney advised at the February 1st meeting that we should come back at this meeting with the resolution accepting that easement.
That easement,
while we're not, you didn't sign it. You didn't have to sign it for it to be recorded, but it does give you the town some express rights to be able to access it for utilities or public safety, whatever the purpose may be. So this simply is that resolution accepting the easement.
Mm-hmm. Any questions for our town manager or Mr. Lighty? If not, do we have a motion to accept this resolution as presented in your package?
I make a motion that we do accept the resolution as included in the package.
Second.
Moved and seconded. In discussion. Not all in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Mic's on. Go order. Next, under new business, Commissioner Ratzenberger, you've had a lot of Alamo Planning Organization ARPO updates.
Well, actually, you got all the update last at the meeting at the beginning of the month. This is a follow-up, and I mentioned that having letters and resolutions ready to go to the legislature, and that's what's in your packet here. And these mirror the ARPO letter, which was staffed. I guess we met on Wednesday, and that weekend, the ARPO, all of us representatives staffed the resolution and the letters and blessed them and got them out in the mail. And then this is simply our endorsement upon. So there shouldn't be any, if there are any questions, I'd be glad, but you've had the long version last week. The only update I have to this, well, first off, there's two letters, one to Senator Cook and to Representative Boswell, about the the transportation study that was given to the legislature, and these mirror the law, our form, our resolution is shorter. It simply mirrors some of the highlights that were in the other one. And I don't think, unless somebody has some questions, I think they're accurate statements. There's also a resolution for us to go forward endorsing the ARPO's request to change the STI law. And that kind of mirrors the comments I had down there. We talked about getting more local impact. The STI, the study did not do what we think we need to do for the rural side. And so we want to point out to them that the upper tiers and the congested people get all the credit already, and we want to carve the dividing lines a little differently. And I think I'm going to make a motion that we send these two letters and the resolution forward.
Okay. Motion's been made. Is there a second to the motion?
I'll second.
Okay. Commissioner, this is Rasmussen. To forward the letters to Senator Cook and Representative Boswell, and also the resolution to the House and Senate.
I'll second the motion.
Okay, any discussion?
I would like to point out one item that in the, it would be item three in our letter to Senator Cook and Representative Boswell about the STI regional and divisional weighting, which I discussed. That now is actually House Bill 81. So that's already into the floor down there. So I'll just let you know that's been submitted.
Ready any further discussion? If not, all in favor of the motion to send the letters that you have copies of to Senator Cook and Representative Boswell, and also to approve the resolution to the House and Senate, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed, like, sign. There being none, it's so ordered.
Thank you.
Next item is consideration of amendment to Town Code Chapter 30, Solid Waste Management. Andy, you up for that one?
Good evening. This particular item relates to the Sanitation Committee's work, where they were asked to come up with a recommendation regarding the schedule for solid waste collection / the appearance of the beach road and the town with regards to rolling back cans. What you have before you tonight is two items, an ordinance which amends Chapter 30 of the Town Code to require that trash and recycling carts be required to be rolled back to a building rather than just out of the right-of-way. This was something that received a lot of discussion by the committee. The committee was in unanimous agreement that the practice of rolling carts just out of the right-of-way and not back to the house is something that really needs to be modified in order to improve the town's appearance the way that the board agrees it should be. And so the current ordinance only requires carts to be rolled back out of the right-of-way, not back to a secure location such as a building. And so this ordinance would modify the town code to do that. Also clarifies when the cart should be rolled out and rolled back. The previous ordinance described a 24-hour period before and after a collection. This simply says the day before scheduled collection and the day after. So that is also included in the ordinance. There are several other changes being included in here. One primary change being the requirement for the number of containers that residential properties must have. Previously, we required one trash cart for every single family dwelling, and that's really all the ordinance said, except for the ordinance required rental properties to have one trash cart for every two bedrooms. The committee talked about this a lot. Obviously, we've added recycling service, and that's taking up some of the volume that would have gone previously in the trash carts. So What the committee settled on was the requirement stay the same for a permanently occupied residential home, but for a rental property, that it be one trash and recycling cart for every three bedrooms. So that does add some recycling carts that weren't previously required. It also reduces the number of trash carts that are required by one. So those are actually the two primary changes to the ordinance that the committee recommended. There are some other fixes to the ordinance, clarifications and housekeeping items, and you've gotten a copy of the ordinance. One of the other things that the committee agreed upon was the idea of sending a letter to all the town property owners, informing them of these changes, expressing the town's concerns over appearance and overflowing trash cans, and really the need to roll these cans back and taking some responsibility in doing that. So you've received in your packet a draft version of a letter that could be sent. The letter also includes information on the ordinance, on the cart requirements that we just described. It talks about where you can get additional parts if your cart needs to be repaired. Talks about how you should be properly marking your cart and not using spray paint on the cart. And really just trying to get information to every property owner about what they should be doing and how they should be managing their trash and recycling carts. And obviously puts them in contact with town staff at Public Works and at Town Hall on where they can get more information. It also discusses where you can find more information on our website regarding the recycling program, the schedule for collection, and what can and can't be recycled in the blue carts. So those were the primary things we were asked to present back to you tonight, and that's what we have for you.
Any questions for Andy? Andy, I think, as I recall, it was part of the committee's recommendation that this be a soft rollout, that we spend a year or two in education before we really got into any type of hard enforcement, that we would kind of roll it out kind of like we did the tents on the beach ordinance, where we had soft.
Right. I mean,
a soft rollout.
You know, the town's ordinance has for years required that the carts be removed from the right of way. Certainly, there were questions at the committee level on whether this new ordinance or the old ordinance could really be enforced. And it certainly would be a major task to go through and enforce every property in town rolling back carts. And so it was generally agreed upon that we would do the best we could to educate people. And, you know, that was the point of the letter. The letter doesn't really talk about penalties or notices of violation. It really just talks about the responsibilities of everyone. And you know, at the committee level, we talked about how it would take 2 or 3 years to really change the culture. And that's what the hope would be with doing the letter. Okay. But yeah, there's no intent to issue penalties, certainly in the first year this goes on the books. You know, the most we might do is, you know, drive a section of the town on a day or two after the collection, you know, mark the addresses where the carts are overflowing and are sitting out, and just make a courtesy call to the owner to just inform them that, you know, there was an issue. And that's probably the most we would do in addition to the education program. We also talked about coming up with some things we could get to the rental properties, the property managers, some clings that would have a clear message on them that people could post in their homes stating what's the proper time to roll the carts out, you know, something real simple and highly visible.
Any questions for Andy?
One thing I think it's important to note, that the section of chapter 30 is the, I think it's 30-57, describes enforcement of chapter 30, and that which relates to penalties for any violation of that, and that hadn't changed. The penalties that existed for years for not rolling the cart back out of the right of way have been there, and that they haven't changed, and we didn't make any edits or changes to that. And I think, and very honestly communicated to you the difficulty of enforcing this ordinance that's always been there. But I think everyone agrees that the carts are an issue and the carts need some attention. And when the committee met, it seemed to always focus back on the carts. and rolling them out of the right-of-way, that's simply not enough, because they're still in the, I mean, it's out of the right-of-way, it's not very far, and ideally, you need the cans back to the house so that if they do blow over, you know, they're not blowing trash all through the right-of-way and down the town. So the penalty section of this is not changed.
Okay, any further questions for Andy?
Can I just make a comment?
Right.
Sir? I just wanted to make mention of the fact that we did have a very active committee on this, several meetings, and extremely well attended, and continuity of attendance. And one of the things that comes across, particularly in this letter, is that the committee was very sensitive to how this would appear to the property owners, how it would be implemented, the time frame, and that type of thing. And I think that this particular letter that's prepared here as a draft is very much in keeping with the sentiment of the committee. It's very positive, it's informative, it's an initial part of the education process, and I think the staff did a great job putting that together.
Okay, thank you, Marvin. Any other discussion?
Yes.
Are we gonna have comments on days of pickup as part of this discussion?
Yeah, I'm lost. What are we? Are we questioning Andy, or are we into the discussion, or what?
I'm asking the mayor a question, as to how we proceed. Are we just going to work on this? Are we going to have further discussion on?
I think this is probably what we've advertised is this discussion as far as the days. Days of discussion, I don't think is what we've advertised as far as part of the agenda. I know we had some information given to each of us on that. And I think that's probably part of this issue, but a separate part of the issue.
Yes.
I would tend to disagree. Mm-hmm. I believe that just from the people that have spoken this evening and comment and feedback that we've been receiving, it wasn't a unanimous decision on the committee. Property managers, at least the ones that have contacted me, still believe that a Monday trash pickup is more desirable. We are talking about solid waste management. We're talking about changing an ordinance. We're talking about rolling the carts in and out. It seems like the day of pickup is relative to the discussion. So if it is not relative to the discussion, then the attorney please tell me, and I'll ask that we put this on a different agenda. But people that have served on the committee believe it's a relevant matter to discuss.
Well, you know, I was on at the committee meetings, and Commissioner Demers was also at the committee meetings, and the committee by far consensus, the agreement was let's do this one step at a time. Let's take an easy stepped approach, and the approach that they recommended was not to change the schedule at this time. Now, if we want to change the schedule, then I think we need to a thorough discussion of that and possibly put it on our March agenda, where we can have a more thorough discussion and everybody's had a chance to really study what needs to be done.
Sorry.
Go ahead.
I was gonna say, was day of pickup not discussed in the committee meetings?
Day of pickup was discussed in the committee meetings, by far the consensus of the committee was that it did not be changed.
Well, there are costs associated with whatever we do. If we're going to do clings and things to educate the public, if this is truly an educational process, we can't just continue to change something every year. It seems like this is the opportunity to fix it all, make it right to the benefit of the entire town, and get the best result. Educate once, create the clings or whatever we're going to give out, make it an all-out effort on solid waste management. That's just my personal opinion.
Mr. Cohen?
In all the discussions that we've had at our board retreat and so forth, I think we got tied into a knot. I think we took two separate issues and tied them into one. Day of pickup versus appearance, because appearance has nothing to do with the day of pickup, except as it relates to aesthetics, especially on the beach road, which was, until this past year, historically Monday, which gives the greatest effect of picking it up on Monday than picking it up on Tuesday, letting the trash be out there. And I understand talking about roll out and all that stuff. And I appreciate the spreadsheet that Commissioner Walters handed out. But I think we need to unravel the two issues. We've got them tied up, and I think we need to unravel. I've heard the comments this evening. I can't say that I disagree. I think I've always thought Monday was the day to pick up the beach road. That's the number one trash day, because turnover is Saturday and Sunday, with Saturday being the predominant day. But I have a hard time saying we're going to send out this letter, but we're not even going to consider input other than the committee. Sorry, there's, and I appreciate the committee, but we are a town that depends on the hospitality industry. And we are, as a town, should be committed to providing the best and most cost-efficient customer service to our industry, our homeowners, and our taxpayers. And I don't think we're doing ourselves a service at all by not trying to do that. And I think we added recycling. It cost us a ton of money to add recycling. And we've got it. Let's make it work. But you can't throw the baby out with the bath and say the garbage doesn't matter anymore, because it does. And appearance became a real big issue after we were discussing real estate signs. And that issue was brought forward. And I think that issue then got tied up in the middle of the day of pickup. But if we're not willing to think about, as part of the appearance day of service, then we're kind of beating our heads against the wall. And I think we live in a community where we have guests, we have temporary or weekend property owners that come down, they roll out, they leave. And it doesn't behoove us to just leave the trash sitting out there for another extra day. I just have a hard time saying we're going to do this, but we're not going to discuss this. I'm appreciative of the committee's work, but I think there is more people that would like to have a voice in this, and we need to think about the town as a whole. We're picking up, we've always picked up on the beach road until this past year. We changed it, went to the west side, which has predominantly most of our year-round residents. We do have rentals on the west side, but we switched the biggest trash day off the beach road. So I'm just...
Commissioner Kern, I think I agree with you in that, but the biggest thing is we're combining two issues together, and we've got to be careful of what we advertise as far as the agenda was concerned. And we didn't talk anything about schedules there. And if we want to change the schedules, I see no reason at all that we can't get the information out and bring it to our March meeting, which will be in 2 weeks, and talk about schedule changes.
Then would the board be willing to consider postponing any action on this until we can have the thorough discussion at the same time?
If I could comment, I've looked at the letter and looked at the ordinance, and neither one of them addresses a schedule. This is what was on the agenda. It's what been worked by the committee. I don't see a basis for postponing this when it's ready to go, and we can start on the following follow-on efforts. If we want to revisit the schedule, certainly we can always revisit any policy anytime, but I'd like to honor the work that the committee has done. It's finalized and ready to be approved and doesn't affect the schedule at all, and go ahead and get this under our belt and move on.
Mayor Pro Tem Walters.
Second paragraph in this letter. You can pick up free brochures and clings at town hall or public works to place in residences for the benefit of guests who may be unfamiliar with our sanitation services. Now, on those clings, do you plan on having a schedule on when the pickup day is? Because that's the most relevant information for them to know when to roll their carts out. So what's going to be on the cling?
We'll have the desire to get folks to roll the cart back to the house, the days that they are supposed to roll the cans out, and the days that they're supposed to roll them back.
Well, then it's directly related. So we can't prepare a cling until we know what the schedule is. I'm not going to vote for something when I don't even know what the schedule is going to be, if that's going to be a subsequent discussion. So if we're not prepared to discuss the overall picture, and we're going to pay for something and send a letter when we don't even have the information yet of what days we're going to use for trash, this is our opportunity to get all this right and not keep changing information for our citizens and guests. So I would support holding off this decision and include the full discussion so we know what cling they're going to pick up at town hall and perhaps provide the schedule within the letter. Just my personal opinion.
Any further discussion?
Yes.
Commissioner Ratzenberger?
I consider these independent discussions. The schedule, and that is what day is something is done is totally separate from the appearance discussion. The appearance discussion to me is carts are put out no sooner than the evening before and they're taken off the day of pickup, period. After that, it doesn't matter what days you're picking up as long as you adhere to the appearance thing. Okay, I have a sneaking suspicion of some of this, and I could be wrong, but some of this talk of scheduling seems to look like, well, gee whiz, we can leave them out there a couple of days and it'll be convenient. This discussion of second homeowners and all that, my question to everybody is do you leave your trash cans out in the road in your hometown when you come down here to visit? I mean, you know, this is our town. The appearance is what counts. Now, the letter and the ordinance can be put into place, and even if we do it as a soft letter over a couple years before we get, you know, hammering on it, it does establish the proper number of carts. It establishes the repair. It cleans up an awful lot of definitions. It puts in the new bulk dumpsters. There's a whole bunch of other things unrelated to any of that that are put into here. I have some issues with the letter in that I don't think there's a specific sentence in the letter that places responsibility on anybody for the rollout, rollback. Now, in the ordinance, paragraph 30-6, I can't read my writing, E, does say,
the owner,
the property owner, agent, or occupant shall be responsible for such. So I think that ought to be, the letter and the ordinance ought to mirror that. There is a discrepancy between the letter and the ordinance in that the letter says it must be placed the night before, which I kind of agree. But the ordinance in 30-6E says no earlier than the day before, which could be the whole morning before the next day's pickup. So there are a couple things there. And then if I were to go through the ordinance, we still have multiple definitions of refuse, solid waste, receptacle versus container, but most of them, I think, if I look at my notes quickly, are more, are kind of niggles rather than, you know, anything substantive, but still, we ought to clean it up such that it's maybe even shorter. But I have, appearance is number one with me. And after that, it doesn't matter. Now, I will say if we're going to change the, you know, to change this to Monday, then we got to throw in the fact that we got to change all the stickers that are already out there, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera, for additional cost. So, but as far as I'm concerned, the commitment needed to be made by everybody, and neither we need to sell to everybody, is night before, day of, appearance of the town. And then the pickup dates are irrelevant.
I will agree with Commissioner Ratzenberger about one thing. There are two separate issues. The ordinance is one issue, and the letter is totally different. The letter, to me, deals with day of the week. The ordinance does not.
I don't think the letter says a day.
Well, but it talks about what's going to happen.
Day before, day after is all it's
all. Well, it's going to have information on it. Mm-hmm. So if we're telling people, they may call us immediately and say, what's the schedule going to be once they get the letter?
Much information, correct information we can put in that letter to ensure that people are doing the night before and the day of.
That's all they. And the sticker on the can says what the day is, or a separate letter, it doesn't matter.
So if you want to separate them out, separate out the ordinance and the letter.
Pickup days don't need to be in the ordinance.
That's correct.
Period. That's what ever. I said. Yeah. That's so the ordinance that could be done.
That's a separate issue.
Separate issue altogether, I think. Any further discussion? Not, do we have a motion?
I would make a motion and keep in mind that in regards to Commissioner Ratzenberger's comments about some of the wording could be cleaned up. I think that wording, those wording changes aren't that significant or aren't significant. So I would make a motion to approve the ordinance as proposed, and that's the end of the motion, and would do a separate motion on the letter to follow.
Is there a second to the motion?
Let me have 1 minute.
Well, I'll second the motion to get it on the floor, so. Any discussion on the motion? Commissioner Ratzenberger, you had a...
No. Commissioner Demers is correct. I made the statement, these are all pretty much wordsmithing. I don't think there's anything fatal in what's here. So I think the ordinance could fly as is, and we can fix the wording later.
Any further discussion on the motion, which is to approve the ordinance as presented? If not, all in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed, like sign. Motion carries 3-2.
Mayor?
Yes.
I have a motion. I make a motion that we delay any action on this letter until the next meeting when we can co-join it to a board discussion in public about scheduling.
Is that a motion?
Yes, it is.
Second to that motion.
Second.
Motion made and seconded that the letter be delayed until we can have a discussion of schedule at your proposal for our March meeting.
Yes, sir. Sooner the better.
Any discussion on that motion?
I have a comment in that regard. The letter refers to refers the owners to the collection schedules and routes on the website. And I think that's a good general reference. If the schedule changes at any time, the website will be changed and be up to date immediately. So I don't see the necessity for tying these two things together. I'd like to see the letter go out. And as a board, if we collectively want to further discuss a schedule, I'm perfectly willing to do that. I'd like to see the letter go out as it is.
I would support the motion because I want to get the responsibility statements clearly delineated in the letter.
Any further discussion? Okay, the motion is to delay the publishing of the letter until we discuss the schedule at our March, publicly at our March meeting. Is that the motion is made? Any further discussion? If not, all in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Opposed, like sign, and it's carried 4-1. Carolyn, I'll ask you to put that on our March agenda. I think we've already got a preliminary.
Do this all over again.
So if you would add that, please.
Put it on the ordinance again, too. So we had a 3-2. Mr. Mayor, I just wanted to point out the since this is the first time the board has voted on the ordinance, you'll need to have another vote at the next meeting.
Right. So the ordinance will be back, will be on our March agenda also.
Okay, thank
That's
you.
A 3-2 vote.
John, the clarification, the non-substantive clarification, that can't be made between now and March 1st?
It can.
It can.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Would you like me to just send you I'll Xerox it, I'll bring it over with me. You can have pencil notes and just do with what you want, you know? It's not.
Okay.
It's my usual.
Items referred to in presentation from a town attorney. Mr. Light, do you have anything for us tonight?
No, sir. Mr. Mayor, I have no presentation tonight.
Any presentation from our town manager?
No, sir.
Come more to commissioner's agenda. Commissioner Cahoon, you wanted to discuss signing for us?
Yes, the local business committee has held multiple meetings discussing items not in the right-of-way but on the edge of property business properties. That was a discussion a lot for the board last year. We invited businesses in to talk about the appearance of those items. We had good communication, good meetings. We've had follow-up meetings in the local business committee, and the recommendation to the Board of Commissioners from the committee is to send a letter to all business owners in the town of Nags Head, reminding them about appearance being so important, as we just talked about with trash, but making them aware of where displays should or should not be, even on your private property. As we talked about earlier, a soft approach. This is the soft approach recommendation from the local business community. And if it doesn't work, I'm sure the business committee will be back with a different recommendation.
Is this the letter you were talking about?
Yes.
The January 17th letter.
Yeah, okay, I missed that one.
Yeah.
That goes under.
This is a sample of the letter for the board.
Okay, any discussion of the letter that is a sample from the local business committee? Any discussion?
Did we talk about this? I was confused by the business committee sending the letter.
That was the recommendation for the business committee rather as a soft approach, since that was the discussion from the business committee. Doesn't matter to me, it can go out under the mayor's
okay.
signature.
I
have no petition. None.
Do we have a motion?
Seems like a mayor issue. But
motion to adopt the letter.
Motion to adopt the letter. Is there a second to that motion?
Second.
Motion made and seconded. Any discussion on the motion? Not all in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed, like sign. There being none, it's so ordered. Yes.
Mayor, I have one more issue that I'd like for us to consider at our March meeting. We heard a presentation from Spencer Rogers here recently, and we also heard the same one but a little bit different at the Coastal Resources Commission earlier this month. And the only way that FEMA will make changes to a flood map is site by site.
Right.
But the problem is not necessarily that. It's in their modeling, and they don't want to change their modeling. And the committee that reviews appeals to maps isn't allowed to consider anything other than did the people that did the modeling do it correctly or incorrectly. As long as they met FEMA guidelines, they did it correctly. I would like for us to consider as a board a resolution at our next meeting to all of our congressional, Congressman Jones and our two senators, as well as the entire North Carolina congressional delegation, outlining them to please take steps in Congress to direct FEMA to correct its modeling.
I think we need include part of that resolution, just some of the problems that we see occurring in our locality anyway.
I think that's appropriate, outline some of the issues, but they will not change their modeling unless so directed by Congress. So if possible.
Is that, we can add that to our March agenda also.
Thank you very much.
Can I ask a question though?
Yes.
And I fully agree with that, although, you know, of course, probably none of us will ever be around by the time they get around to it.
That may be.
But also, Spencer did mention, and I didn't bring any of my notes, so I don't have it with, I don't have the term he used. He says there is a way, effectively, it's a blanket request or a blanket appeal that is not the site by site, give us all your data stuff. And he even mentioned that we do have a lot of that data here already in the numeric studies that we have. I think probably, and I may be branching off here, we may need to, and I'll look up the term and email it tonight, but we may need to look at doing that sort of an appeal as part of our decision as to adopt or not adopt. In there, I think there's multiple paths to take on this thing.
I totally agree with what you're saying. That, to me, the flood maps are, what we do with the current maps that we have to look at are one thing, but thinking about for the future, getting congressional action so we don't have to do this again.
Right. Yeah, there has to be a better way of doing that than so that, they did.
That's why I brought the issue forward to look at that.
Very good. Thank you. Need to talk about CIP and budget workshop schedules. I think we did those at our last meeting. Any of those that need to be changed? I can't recall whether we set the CIP or not.
I don't know what those are. I'm sorry. I wasn't here. I apologize. I have no idea what those dates are.
CIP is March 15th, I think.
Are they on the calendar?
Yeah, I'm not sure they're on the calendar.
The budget, it's in your packet here. May 10th and 17th for the budget.
Sorry.
For the budget, right.
But CIP, I have the 13th of March.
15 March.
All right, I wasn't sure about that. I was.
Okay, I'm sorry. I guess I have it wrong then. If everybody has it 15,
I have it 15.
Okay, yeah,
that's the day of your mid-month board meeting.
Right.
Which can prove to be a long day.
Okay.
Uh-huh. Like today.
For you all, not for us.
That's right.
Didn't have
a
time.
CIP workshop is March 15th, right? And you've got the other two dates are in May.
But what time on the...
Yeah, we never settled the length of this. That was the deal.
Mm-hmm. What time do you prefer?
Are we also having a meeting?
Yeah, I would expect so. I would expect so. You want to do it at 3 o'clock again and have a long afternoon, or would you rather do it earlier in the day and have?
I'd rather do it early, like 9 o'clock, and then have a break in between before our board meeting.
All right, 9 o'clock. Agreeable.
Suggestion.
Mm-hmm.
Do you have a peak meeting at,
You do.
At 11? That TV time?
Let me see, you'll probably do.
Well, we can do it after peak, I don't care, but we'll leave enough time to get it done.
That would, to do that would put us at 1 o'clock, probably.
All right.
So 1 o'clock?
Let's do it at 1 o'clock.
Are you gonna put that on the calendar, Carolyn?
Yes, I'll do that.
Okay.
And then the two, May meetings?
I think we approved those last time.
Yeah, but when?
Start date, I mean, start time.
Those, what is time to start on the 9 o'clock meetings?
Do you have another peak meeting on the 17th of May?
We can adjust it.
We can adjust that one, probably.
I won't be here on the 10th, but I'll be here on the 17th.
Could we move it up a day, the 9th and the 17th?
In May? I got Shoreline Management Committee that day, but other than that, I think we could. Will you be in town tonight?
No.
Not that either.
So don't adjust for me.
You all that week?
Just do what you need to do.
Yeah, you're out of town all week that week, aren't you?
Until I don't look at the board calendar that much. I don't look at the board calendar that much. I listen as we discuss in here.
Let's do it the 17th, the 10th and the, what was it, 10th and 17th? And start those at 9 o'clock. And we'll have to change the nursing home meeting that day, Cliff.
Yes, sir.
Mayor, can I have, before we just end, can I have one more minute?
Yeah.
The Bike Ped Committee approved the Dominion Power grant request going through them.
Good.
So I just want to let the board know that and ask that we send a letter under your signature thanking them for moving that forward.
Thank you very much for making that.
Thank you. One other thing that I have is Town Hall Day is Wednesday, and with the North Carolina League of Municipalities, it's Wednesday, March 29th. I usually go to that, but I will not be able to go this year. Do we have others who would like to go and attend that Town Hall Day and talk with our representatives in Raleigh?
You asked if we'd like to go.
Yeah.
Would you go? I'll change it. Well,
yeah, I'm available.
If you're available, I think we need representation there. I'm in the process of moving that day, so I know that I'll be tied up.
I guess you will.
As long as we can make this a day down and a day
Marvin,
back,
how about you?
The same day.
You go?
I'm available, and you know, we'd be better served as a two-man team, two-person team.
I think it would be better. And Mr. Ogwin, you will be attending that, I assume.
Gentleman to Raleigh. I will accompany.
Be a gentleman to Raleigh, okay?
Oh darn! There goes all our fun, Marvin.
There you go.
Okay, and that's a day trip, right?
Yes, sir.
As always, okay. Day trip, all right.
A day trip, right?
Got it.
Day trip.
Anything else we need to talk about tonight?
Get Marvin his green tie. You got a green tie already, don't you? You got green. There you go.
If not, I will entertain a motion for adjournment.
The move.
Is there a second to the motion for adjournment? Moved and seconded. All in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Aye.